Hey guys, it's Jake. Welcome to another episode of Tech Booth Makeover here at Self Fellowship Church. And in this episode, I want to show you guys our new broadcast audio mixing solution. This is the process that we're using at our church to mix our audio so it sounds almost radio ready by the time that our congregation hears it as they're streaming worship from home. This method is called mixing in a box. You've seen this at churches like Bethel with Luke Hendrickson. You also have seen this at churches like Life Church and even Red Rocks. This is a really fantastic way to mix and process audio and even master audio in real time for your church's live stream. What I really love about this type of setup is how accessible it is from a cost standpoint. Instead of having to purchase a completely new digital mixing console, I actually just purchased a base Mac Mini with the M1 chip, which was around $700. And then of course I've got my DAW, Ableton Live, which is a few hundred dollars. And then I have some plugins, which were a few hundred dollars. So if I added it all up with this setup, it probably costs, I'm gonna ballpark, somewhere around $1,500, $1,600, maybe $1,700 with all the accessories I have for this computer. So in this video, I wanna break down for you every single aspect of this setup when it comes to the computer, the software, plugins, control surfaces, so you could possibly replicate this at your church. I think this setup would work great for a lot of smaller to mid-sized churches out there. This video is brought to you by Broadcast Mix Mastery. It's our online course that walks you very in-depth through this whole process. Even if you have zero experience working with a digital audio workstation like Ableton, if you have zero experience routing audio to and from a mixing console to a computer like this to mix down your audio and then to send it to your live stream, we cover it all. You'll also get access to the templates we've built for students of this course. So you'll have access to our template that has just stock plugins that come with Ableton Live. And you'll also get access to our more advanced templates that uses a bunch of Waves plugins. Those are third-party plugins that cost a bit extra on top of Ableton Live. We're really not big fans of just selling templates because we understand that it kind of requires some experience with digital audio workstations and routing audio and mixing to actually truly understand this process and get the best results. So that's why we have a comprehensive online course paired with our templates. So click the link below to learn more about the course and enroll today. So let's talk about this broadcast mixing solution that I have set up here. So as you guys know, I mentioned in previous videos, we want to have the flexibility to mix for our broadcast here in the tech booth. And then eventually someday I want to have a separate room that we can mix in. Of course, it's going to be more ideal to have a separate room to mix for broadcast. Even if you have good headphones, you can still feel, the bass within the room. So it's not the perfect mixing experience, but you can still get some fantastic results. So currently I have my broadcast mix station just set up on the front table here. Our mixing console is right next to me, then our Pro Presenter machine. Eventually we're gonna have a table behind the front section of the tech booth here. We'll have one behind for video switching and broadcast audio to kind of separate it a little bit more and give us a little bit more space to work with. So first, let's do a hardware rundown of the actual gear I'm using for this system. Like I already mentioned, I'm using the base model Mac Mini that has the M1 chip, and it's got 8 gigabytes of RAM. It's got 256 gigabytes of space on the hard drive. And I've tested this already on a Sunday with a complete full band running through Ableton Live and all the plugins running, and it worked flawlessly. I do have the buffer size on this computer set all the way up to 2048 samples, giving the computer plenty of time to process the audio through Ableton Live. And it actually doesn't even create enough latency to sync perfectly with video. I'm still applying about 100 milliseconds of delay on my master bus coming out of Ableton before it's sent to the video switcher. So my point I want to emphasize here is that so far this base model M1 Mac Mini worked great. If you want, you could get a Mac Mini with upgraded RAM of 16 gigabytes of RAM, but we're not running a bunch of applications on this computer, and Ableton's not really coming anywhere near taking up more than 8 gigabytes of RAM to run this mix. Ableton's only using about 2 gigabytes of RAM, and then when I'm looking at the CPU usage in Ableton, it hovers around just 30%. The next piece of gear we have in this setup is the CalDigit Thunderbolt dock. I pretty much get this Thunderbolt dock for every single workstation that I've built in our studio here in the church now, because it just adds a bunch of connectivity with USB ports, a daisy chain Thunderbolt port, and then also plenty of ports for plugging in extra hard drives over USB-C or other things like the mouse and keyboard over USB-A and the trackpad as well. And then it also has an SD card slot. So I love that Thunderbolt dock, and pretty much we're gonna use this at every new computer workstation. I also have a portable 2 terabyte G drive, solid state drive. That was a long description of that device, but it's a solid state hard drive. It's portable, 2 terabytes. And that's where we actually store all of our Ableton projects in session. So I'm not actually saving all the files onto the computer's local hard drive. Another important thing that I like to think about is my computer mouse and keyboard and trackpad. So on my right hand, I've got my Logitech MX Master 3 mouse. This is my favorite mouse that I like to use for all of our workstations. Then I've got the Logitech MX Keys. It's a nice low profile keyboard. Really love it. It's also quiet, so it's like a mechanical keyboard. It's kind of like a cross between a mechanical keyboard and a keyboard you'll find on a modern laptop. It's mechanical, but it's not super loud and doesn't have a bunch of clackety noise, which you don't want to have in a production booth. And then we've got a Magic Trackpad 2, I believe. It's a space gray one. And I really like the ergonomics of having the mouse on my right hand and then the trackpad on my left, so I can easily scroll, you know, through the session view on Ableton Live and view my mixer. Or I could also easily scroll through the timeline as well in arrangement view. And then these displays are 24-inch LG 1080p displays. I love these displays. I think they're around $130 on Amazon, and I've bought a ton of these as well for various workstations. 1080p, it actually looks crisp enough for this type of work. It's not like I'm doing a bunch of video or photo editing here, so these work great. And then when you have two monitors plugged into the computer, Ableton Live does have the dual monitor mode here. And then if I toggle between session view and arrangement view, it'll just flip which monitor each view is on. Next up, we have the PreSonus Faderport 8 production controller. So this can control my Ableton session via MIDI. So it's a really easy setup process. You just pretty much plug it in, you go into preference and MIDI and Ableton, and just tell it to use this device over the Mackie protocol, and it both sends and receives MIDI. So if I were to go in and, you know, adjust any of these faders here, like here's our lead vocalist fader, I adjust it here in the DAW, and it's also adjusting it here down on the fader port. Or if I adjust it on the fader port, it's gonna adjust it in the software. Another important piece of hardware I have next to this computer is this headphone amplifier and distributor. So we can actually have multiple people back here listening to the mix on headphones. And this is especially great when we're training new mix engineers for broadcast mix. The headphones that I have here are just some basic Audio Technica M50 headphones. They're pretty standard headphones, and I think they're also pretty affordable. I also like using a pair of Behr Dynamic DT770s, closed-backed headphones. Those sound really great, and they're very comfortable. And sometimes I'll use my Allclear RSM quad drivers. They're custom in-ear monitors, and those have even better isolation from the room. Finally, I want to note that the way we're getting audio from the mixing console to this computer is over just USB. I'm still waiting on the Dante card to come in for the wing. I have it on pre-order at Sweetwater. They said I'm first in line to get that Dante card once they actually have them in stock. I'm very, very excited for it. And who knows the timing of when the M1 Mac will actually be compatible with it. I think I saw somewhere on Audinate's website, maybe around April, which is, you know, only a month away now. So we can be patient and just kind of live with just the USB connection, even if the Dante card comes sooner than later. But of course, Dante is great for other purposes than just the broadcast audio. And you guys know I've mentioned in previous videos how much I'm loving the Behringer Wing. And even for this use case of sending audio over USB to this computer, like the routing process on the Wing is so much more intuitive than it used to be on the X32 or M32. So I'm really loving that process, because it takes me like, you know, a couple seconds now if I need to change any routing over USB. It's very intuitive on the Wing's interface. So that's all the hardware in the setup. Now let's talk about the software. The primary software we are using, of course, is Ableton Live. It's the newest version of Ableton, Ableton 11, that just came out, and it's the standard version. So we don't have any limits on track count, but I don't need Suite because I'm not doing like a bunch of producing, and I don't need a bunch of the instruments that Ableton Live Suite comes with. Standard works just fine for this environment. And I already mentioned to you that I was able to increase the buffer size as high as it can go, up to 2048, so that we don't have any processing issues and it's taking it easy on the processor here in the M1 Mac. And you can use other DAWs like there, like Logic, like Pro Tools, like Studio One, like Reaper, whichever DAW you choose. I just like Ableton Live because I feel like it's just very efficient on a CPU. There's also great flexibility when it comes to routing, audio in and out. Unlike Pro Tools, I know the other DAWs also have the same flexibility as Ableton Live, but I just think, you know, since Live was designed for a live environment, they've just designed it in a way that I feel like is really reliable and stable, and so far it's really worked well for us. And then in our mixing template, we're using mostly Waves plugins. We've got the SSL channel plugins and the LA compressors, as well as we're using Waves Tune real time for vocal tuning. And it's just amazing what these plugins do. And again, it's important to get a good source tone, have good gain structure coming in to each of these channels and through the plugins. You want to make sure nothing's too soft, nothing's clipping anywhere. But I just love the ability to have pretty much, you know, unlimited buses when you're working in a DAW. So you can process each individual vocal, you can put that into a vocal bus, and then you can, you know, process all of your vocals within one bus, and then you can do the same thing for all your instruments, and then put your instruments through a bus, and then you can put some mastering plugins on your master bus, and it really just smooths out the final mix, and we've been really happy with the results. So that's it from a software standpoint. You just got Ableton Live, some of the built-in plugins with Ableton, and then also the Waves plugins, but you don't need all the Waves plugins. You could just use a lot of the native plugins that come with Ableton. Let's talk about audio routing and how we've kind of set this up so that we're sending audio to the right place to our program feed for our live stream, as well as we can monitor audio. So you probably are familiar with the concept of how we get audio to the computer over USB. We're sending a multi-track audio from the Wing into the Mac Mini, and then Ableton pulls in that multi-track audio. We can process and mix all those channels, and then we send it out USB 1 and 2 from Ableton Live here, and it goes back to our Behringer Wing to do our digital to analog conversion. And I also like the flexibility of sending it back to the Wing in case if we want to route that broadcast audio somewhere, you know, within the building. We have the option to do that. So once it gets back to the Wing in a channel called broadcast audio, of course, we're usually not sending that audio to the masters during a service. That would not make any sense, except when we're doing like lobby announcements and piping in that feed in here. That's something new we're experimenting with. But we have that flexibility. So once it is in that channel, it's then sent directly to the ATEM switcher. So out of the two local XLR outputs on the back of the console, that's where it does the digital to audio conversion. And then it goes into the ATEM switcher, stereo left and right. And then from the ATEM, we actually have audio outputs as well. So then we're actually sending two XLR outputs from the back of the ATEM into our headphone amplifier, so that what we are monitoring is indeed the audio in the switcher. So we get to hear the audio before it's then encoded and sent online. So that's the way we're routing audio right now with this system. Like I said, someday I hope to have a separate broadcast audio suite in a video suite, like a lot of the larger churches do out there, but currently that's just not really feasible with our setup, especially because we don't have Dante audio networking yet. That's the one technical thing kind of holding us back from being able to do this. I'm sure we could find some random space or closet within the church, and then all we have to do is send it a Ethernet for Dante, as well as a program feed line, so, or multi-view, so the broadcast audio person can see what's going on. It's just funny because one of the last videos I made about this, I said we're putting the broadcast mixing solution in the tech booth, and I said, yeah, it's not ideal, I want to have another space. And then of course there's commenters who are like, oh, Jake, you're not going to be able to hear your mix properly when you're trying to mix in the room with the band. Of course, I know it's not ideal, But you guys know how it is. If you're most churches, nothing's ideal ever, but you just kind of work with it. So really like the setup. It's been working great. And I also think it's actually easier to train volunteers on a DAW like this, and it's easier to set them up for success because there's so many cool things you can do with like keyboard commands and using a controller like this fader port. I think it's actually less intimidating than putting someone behind a regular mixing console, even like the Wing. So I've been talking for about 25 minutes, and this was just supposed to be kind of a quick overview of the setup. I guess you can see there's quite a bit going on here. And if you really want to dive deep into the details of how to configure this at your church, especially, again, if you're new to audio routing and using a DAW and mixing in a DAW and getting the feed properly to your live stream, making sure that it's loud enough and clear enough, if this is something that you've struggled with and you want help with, the Broadcast Mixer Mastery course really breaks it all down into simple building blocks that anybody can understand. You don't need an audio engineering degree or a ton of experience. We've walked people through setting this up when they were completely green when it comes to working with these types of tools. So click the link below this video to enroll in Broadcast Mix Mastery. I also want to encourage you, you can check out our complete program at Worship Ministry School. You can hop on a free strategy session when you apply, and we could talk about your ministry goals and what the best fit might be if you were to work with us. So go to worshipministryschool.com, click the apply button to learn more. And I'm just grateful for you guys taking the time out of your day to watch this video. Please hit like, share with your worship ministry friends if you found it helpful. And I look forward to seeing you next time.